Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Practicing History, Selected Essays by Barbara W. Tuchman, narrated by Aviva Skell. This book is copyrighted 1981 by Alma Tuchman, Lucy T. Eisenberg, and Jessica Tuchman Matthews. This recording is copyrighted 1987 by Recorded Books. In her preface to this collection of essays and articles, the author Barbara Tuchman writes, "Whether these selections, when gathered together, offer any philosophy of history is a question I hesitate to answer, because I'm rather afraid of philosophies. They contain a risk for the historian of being tempted to manipulate his facts in the interest of his system, which results in histories stronger in ideology than how it really was. Yet I don't suppose one can practice the writing of history over a long period without arriving at certain principles and guidelines. From these essays emerges, I think, a sense of history as accidental and perhaps cyclical of human conduct, as a steady stream that runs through endless fields of changing circumstances, of good and bad always coexisting and inextricably mixed in periods as in people, of cross-currents and counter-currents, usually present to contradict too easy generalizations. As to treatment, I believe the material must precede the thesis that chronological narrative is the spine and the bloodstream that brings history closer to how it really was, and to a proper understanding of cause and effect. That whatever the subject, it must be written in terms of what was known and believed at the time, not from the perspective of hindsight, for otherwise the result will be invalid. While laying no claim to originality, these are principles I discovered for myself in the course of learning the craft and following the practice of my profession. And now, Practicing History, Part 1, The Craft. When does history happen?
Within 3 months of the Conservative Party crisis in Britain last October, a book by Randolph Churchill on the day-to-day history of the affair had been written and published. To rush in upon an event before its significance has had time to separate from the surrounding circumstances may be surprising, but is it useful? An embarrassed author may find, when the excitement has died down, that his subject had little significance at all. The recent prevalence of these hot histories on publishers' lists raises the question, should, or perhaps can, history be written while it's still smoking? Before taking that further, one must first answer the question, what is history? Professional historians have been exercising themselves vehemently over this query for some time. A distinguished exponent, E.H. Carr of Cambridge University, made it the subject of his Trevelyan lectures and the title of a book in 1962. Is history, he asked, the examination of past events, or is it the past events themselves? By good luck, I did not read the book until after I had finished an effort of my own at historical narrative. Otherwise, I should never have dared to begin. In my innocence, I hadn't been aware that the question posed by Mr. Carr had ever come up. I had simply assumed that history was past events existing independently, whether we examined them or not. I had thought that we who comment on the past were extraneous to it, helpful perhaps to its understanding, but not integral to its existence. I had supposed that the Greeks' defeat of the Persians would have given the same direction to Western history, whether Herodotus chronicled it or not. But that is not Mr. Carr's position. The belief in a hard core of historical facts existing independently of the interpretation of the historian, he says, is a preposterous fallacy, but one that is very hard to eradicate. On first reading, this seemed to me to be preposterous nonsense. Was it some sort of recondite joke? But a thinker of such eminence must be taken seriously, and after prolonged silent arguments with Mr. Carr, of which he remained happily unaware, I began to see what he was driving at. What he means, I suppose, is that past events cannot exist independently of the historian, because without the historian, we would know nothing about them. In short, that the unrecorded past is none other than our old friend, the tree in the primeval forest which fell where there was no one to hear the sound of the crash. If there was no ear, was there a sound? I refuse to be frightened by that conundrum because it asks the wrong question. The point isn't whether the fall of the tree made a noise, but whether it left a mark on the forest. If it left a space that let in the sun on a hitherto shade-grown species, or if it killed a dominant animal and shifted rule of the pack to one of different characteristics, or if it fell across a path of animals and caused some small change in their habitual course from which larger changes followed, then the fall made history, whether anyone heard it or not. I therefore declare myself a firm believer in the preposterous fallacy of historical facts existing independently of the historian. I think that if Domesday Book and all other records of the time had been burned, the transfer of land ownership from the Saxons to the Normans would be no less a fact of British history. Of course, Domesday Book was a record, not an interpretation, and what Mr. Carr says is that historical facts don't exist independently of the interpretation of historians. I find this untenable. He might just as well say the Grecian urn wouldn't exist without Keats. As I see it, evidence is more important than interpretation, and facts are history whether interpreted or not. I think the influence of the receding frontier on American expansion was a phenomenon independent of Frederick Jackson Turner, who noticed it, and the role of the leisure class, independent of Thorstein Veblen, and the influence of sea power upon history, independent of Admiral Mahon. In the last case lurks a possible argument for the opposition, because Admiral Mahon's book, The Influence of Sea Power Upon History, so galvanized the naval policy of Imperial Germany and Great Britain in the years before 1914, that in isolating and describing a great historical fact, he himself made history. Mr. Carr might make something of that. Meanwhile, I think his main theme unnecessarily metaphysical. I'm content to define history as the past events of which we have knowledge, and refrain from worrying about those of which we have none, until, that is, some archaeologist digs them up. I come next to historians. Who are they, contemporaries of the event or those who come after? The answer is obviously both. Among contemporaries, first and indispensable, are the more or less unconscious sources— letters, diaries, memoirs, autobiographies, newspapers and periodicals, business and government documents. These are historical raw material, not history. Their authors may be writing with one eye, or possibly both, on posterity, but that doesn't make them historians. To perform that function requires a view from the outside and a conscious craft. At a slightly different level are the I-was-there recorders, usually journalists, whose accounts often contain golden nuggets of information buried in a mass of daily travelogue which the passage of time has reduced to trivia. Some of the most vivid details that went into my book, The Guns of August, came from the working press. The rag doll crushed under the wheel of a German gun carriage from Irvin Cobb. The smell of 500,000 unwashed bodies that hung over the invaded villages of Belgium from Will Irwin. The incident of Colonel Max Hoffman yelling insults at the Japanese general from Frederick Palmer, who reported the Russo-Japanese War. Daily journalism, however, even when collected in book form, is, like letters and the rest, essentially source material rather than history. Still contemporary, but dispensable, are the compilers who hurriedly assemble a book from clippings and interviews in order to capitalize on public interest when it's high. A favorite form of these hasty puddings is the overnight biography like The Lyndon Johnson Story, which was in the bookstores within a few weeks of the incident that gave rise to it. The compilers in their treatment supply no extra understanding and, as historians, are negligible. All these varieties being disposed of, there remains a pure vein of conscious historians of whom, among contemporaries, there are two kinds. First, the onlookers, who deliberately set out to chronicle an episode of their own age, a war or depression or strike or social revolution or whatever it may be, and shape it into a historical narrative with character and validity of its own. Thucydides' Peloponnesian Wars, on a major scale, and Theodore White's The Making of a President, undertaken in the same spirit, though on a tiny scale in comparison, are examples. Second are the active participants, or axe grinders, who attempt a genuine history of events they have known, but whose accounts are inevitably weighted, sometimes subtly and imperceptibly, sometimes crudely, by the requirements of the role in which they wish themselves to appear. Josephus, The Jewish War, the Earl of Clarendon's History of the Rebellion, and Winston Churchill's World Crisis and Second World War are classics of this category. For the latter-day historian, these two become source material. Are we now in possession of history when we have these accounts in hand? Yes, in the sense that we're in possession of wine when the first pressing of the grapes is in hand. But it hasn't fermented, and it hasn't aged. The great advantage of the latter-day historian is the distance conferred by the passage of time. At a distance from the events he describes and with a wider area of vision, he can see more of what was going on at the time and distinguish what was significant from what was not. The contemporary has no perspective. Everything is in the foreground and appears the same size. Little matters loom big, and great matters are sometimes missed because their outlines can't be seen. Vietnam and Panama are given four-column headlines today, but the historian 50 or 100 years hence will put them in a chapter under a general heading we haven't yet thought of. The contemporary, especially if he's a participant, is inside his events, which is not entirely an unmixed advantage. What he gains in intimacy through personal acquaintance, which we can never achieve, he sacrifices in detachment. He can't see or judge fairly both sides in a quarrel, for example, the quarrel as to who deserves chief credit for the French victory at the Battle of the Marne in 1914. All contemporary chroniclers were extreme partisans of either Joffre or Galliani. So violent was the partisanship that no one except President Poincaré noticed what is so clearly visible when viewed from a distance, that both generals had played an essential role. Galliani saw the opportunity and gave the impetus. Joffre brought the army and the reinforcements into place to fight, but it took 50 years before this simple and just apportionment could be made. Distance doesn't always confer objectivity. One can hardly say Gibbon wrote objectively of the Roman Empire or Carlyle of the French Revolution. Objectivity is a question of degree. It's possible for the latter-day historian to be at least relatively objective, which isn't the same thing as being neutral or taking no sides. There's no such thing as a neutral or purely objective historian. Without an opinion, a historian would be simply a ticking clock, and unreadable besides. Nevertheless, distance does confer a kind of removal that cools the judgment and permits a juster appraisal than is possible to a contemporary. Once, long ago, as a freshman journalist, I covered a campaign swing by Franklin D. Roosevelt, during which he was scheduled to make a major speech at Pittsburgh or Harrisburg, I forget which. As we were leaving the train, one of the newspaper men remained comfortably behind in the club car with his feet up, explaining that as a New Dealer writer for a Republican paper, he had to remain objective, and he could be a lot more objective right here than within 10 feet of that fellow. He was using distance in space, if not in time, to acquire objectivity. I found out from personal experience that I couldn't write contemporary history if I tried. Some people can, William Shirer for one. They are not affected by involvement. But I am, as I discovered when working on my first book, Bible and Sword. It dealt with the historical relations between Britain and Palestine from the time of the Phoenicians to the present. Originally, I had intended to bring the story down through the years of the British Mandate to the Arab-Israeli War and the re-establishment of the State of Israel in 1948. I spent 6 months of research on the bitter history of those last 30 years, the Arab assaults and uprisings, the roundtables, the white papers, the cutting off of Jewish immigration, the commissions of inquiry, the ultimate historical irony when the British, who had issued the Balfour Declaration, rammed the ship Exodus, the whole ignominious tale of one or more chapters of appeasement. When I tried to write this as history, I couldn't do it. Anger, disgust, and a sense of injustice can make some writers eloquent and evoke brilliant polemic, but these emotions stunted and twisted my pen. I found the tone of my concluding chapter totally different from the 17 chapters that went before. I had suddenly walked over the line into contemporary history. I'd become involved, and it showed. Although the publisher wanted the narrative brought up to date, I knew my final chapter as written would destroy the credibility of all the preceding, and I couldn't change it. I tore it up, discarded 6 months of work, and brought the book to a close in 1918. I'm not saying that emotion should have no place in history. On the contrary, I think it's an essential element of history, as it is of poetry, whose origin Wordsworth defined as emotion recollected in tranquility. History, one might say, is emotion plus action recollected, or in the case of latter-day historians, reflected on in tranquility after a close and honest examination of the records. The primary duty of the historian is to stay within the evidence, yet it's a curious fact that poets, limited by no such rule, have done very well with history, both of their own times and of times long gone before. Tennyson wrote The Charge of the Light Brigade within 3 months of the event at Balaclava in the Crimea. Cannon in front of them volleyed and thundered, flashed all their sabers bare, plunged in the battery smoke, stormed at with shot and shell. When can their glory fade? Oh, the wild charge they made! His version, even including the Victorian couplet, "Theirs not to reason why, theirs but to do and die," as poetry, may lack the modern virtue of incomprehensibility, but as history it captures that combination of the glorious and the ridiculous, which was a 19th-century cavalry charge against cannon. As an onlooker said, "C'est magnifique, mais ce n'est pas la guerre." It is magnificent, but it is not war. Which is exactly what Tennyson conveyed better than any historian. To me, who grew up before Bruce Catton began writing, the Civil War will always appear in terms of up from the meadows rich with corn, clear in the cool September morn, the clustered spires of Frederick stand. Whittier, too, was dealing in contemporary history. Macaulay, on the other hand, wrote Horatius at the Bridge some 2,500 years after the event. Although he was a major historian and only secondarily a poet, would any of us remember anything about Tarquin the Tyrant or Roman history before Caesar if it were not for Lars Porsena of Clusium, by the nine gods he swore, and the rest of the 70 stanzas? We know how the American Revolution began from Longfellow's signal lights in the Old North Church. "One if by land and two if by sea, and I on the opposite shore will be, ready to ride and spread the alarm through every Middlesex village and farm." The poets have familiarized more people with history than have the historians, and sometimes they've given history a push. Kipling did it in 1899 with his bidding, "Take up the white man's burden," addressed to Americans who, being plunged into involuntary imperialism by Admiral Dewey's adventure in Manila, were sorely perplexed over what to do about the Philippines. "Send forth the best ye breed," Kipling told them firmly. "To wait in heavy harness, on fluttered folk and wild, your new-caught sullen peoples, half-devil and half-child. Take up the white man's burden, the savage wars of peace, fill full the mouth of famine, and bid the sickness cease. Take up the white man's burden, ye dare not stoop to less." The advice, published in a 2-page spread by McClure's magazine, was quoted across the country within a week and quickly reconciled most Americans to the expenditure of bullets, brutality, and trickery that soon proved necessary to implement it. Kipling had a peculiar gift for recognizing history at close quarters. He wrote Recessional in 1897 at the time of the Queen's Diamond Jubilee, when he sensed a self-glorification, a kind of hubris in the national mood that frightened him. In The Times, on the morning after, when people read his reminder, "Lo, all our pomp of yesterday is one with Nineveh and Tyre. Judge of the nations, spare us yet, lest we forget." It created a profound impression. Sir Edward Clarke, the distinguished barrister who defended Oscar Wilde, was so affected by the message that he pronounced Recessional the greatest poem written by any living man. What the poets did was to convey the feeling of an episode or a moment of history as they sensed it. The historian's task is rather to tell what happened within the discipline of the facts. What his imagination is to the poet, facts are to the historian. His exercise of judgment comes in their selection, his art in their arrangement. His method is narrative. His subject is the story of man's past. His function is to make it known.
This ends. When does history happen? And now, history by the arms.
At a party given for its reopening last year, the Museum of Modern Art in New York served champagne to 5,000 guests. An alert reporter for The Times, Charlotte Curtis, noticed that there were 80 cases, which she informed her readers amounted to 960 bottles or 7,683-ounce drinks. Somehow through this detail, the museum's party at once becomes alive, a fashionable New York occasion. One sees the crush, the women eyeing each other's clothes, the exchange of greetings, and feels the gratifying sense of elegance and importance imparted by champagne, even if, at 1.5 drinks per person, it wasn't on an exactly riotous scale. All this is conveyed by Miss Curtis' detail. It is, I think, the way history as well as journalism should be written. It's what Poobah in the Mikado meant when telling how the victim's head stood on its neck and bowed 3 times to him at the execution of Nanki Poo. He added that this was corroborative detail intended to give artistic verisimilitude to an otherwise bald and unconvincing narrative. Not that Miss Curtis' narrative was either bald or unconvincing. On the contrary, it was precise, factual, and a model in every way. But what made it excel, made it vivid and memorable, was her use of corroborative detail. Poobah's statement of the case establishes him in my estimate as a major historian, or at least as the formulator of a major principle of historiography. True, he invented his corroborative detail, which is cheating if you're a historian and fiction if you're not. Nevertheless, what counts is his recognition of its importance. He knew that it supplies verisimilitude, that without it a narrative is bald and unconvincing. Neither he nor I, of course, discovered the principle. Historians have for long made use of it, beginning with Thucydides, who insisted on details of topography, the appearance of cities and localities, the description of rivers and harbors, the peculiar features of seas and countries and the relative distances. Corroborative detail is the great corrective. Without it, historical narrative and interpretation both may slip easily into the invalid. It is a disciplinarian. It forces the historian who uses and respects it to cleave to the truth, or as much as he can find out of the truth. It keeps him from soaring off the ground into theories of his own invention. On these Toynbee heights, the air is stimulating and the view is vast, but people and houses down below are too small to be seen. However persuaded the historian may be of the validity of the theories he conceives, if they are not supported and illustrated by corroborative detail, they are of no more value as history than Poobah's report of the imagined execution. It's wiser, I believe, to arrive at theory by way of the evidence rather than the other way around, like so many revisionists today. It's more rewarding, in any case, to assemble the facts first, and in the process of arranging them in narrative form, to discover a theory or a historical generalization emerging of its own accord. This, to me, is the excitement, the built-in treasure hunt of writing history. In the book I'm working on now, which deals with a 20-year period before 1914, and the reader must forgive me if all my examples are drawn from my own work, but that, after all, is the thing one knows best, I have been writing about a moment during the Dreyfus affair in France, when on the day of the reopening of Parliament, everyone expected the army to attempt a coup d'état. English observers predicted it, troops were brought into the capital, the royalist pretender was summoned to the frontier, mobs hooted and rioted in the streets, but when the day had passed, nothing had happened. The Republic still stood. By this time, I'd assembled so much corroborative detail pointing to a coup d'état that I had to explain why it had not occurred. Suddenly, I had to stop and think. After a while, I found myself writing, "The right lacked that necessary chemical of a coup, a leader. It had its small, if loud, fanatics, but to upset the established government in a democratic country requires either foreign help or the stuff of a dictator." That's a historical generalization, I believe. A modest one, to be sure, but my size. I had arrived at it out of the necessity of the material and felt immensely pleased and proud. These moments don't occur every day. Sometimes no more than once a chapter, if that. But when they do, they leave one with a lovely sense of achievement. I'm a disciple of the ounce because I mistrust history in gallon jugs, whose purveyors are more concerned with establishing the meaning and purpose of history than with what happened. Is it necessary to insist on a purpose? No one asks the novelist why he writes novels, or the poet what's his purpose in writing poems. The lilies of the field, as I remembered, were not required to have a demonstrable purpose. Why can't history be studied and written and read for its own sake, as the record of human behavior, the most fascinating subject of all? Insistence on a purpose turns the historian into a prophet, and that's another profession. To return to my own, corroborative detail won't produce a generalization every time, but it will often reveal a historical truth, besides keeping one grounded in historical reality. When I was investigating General Mercier, the Minister of War, who was responsible for the original condemnation of Dreyfus, and who, in the course of the affair, became the hero of the right, I discovered that at parties of the Haut Monde, ladies rose to their feet when General Mercier entered the room. That's the kind of detail which, to me, is worth a week of research. It illustrates the society, the people, the state of feeling at the time more vividly than anything I could write, and in short space, too, which is an additional advantage. It epitomizes, it crystallizes, it visualizes. The reader can see it. Moreover, it sticks in his mind. It is memorable. The same is true verbally, though not visually, of a statement by President Eliot of Harvard in 1896, in a speech on international arbitration, a great issue of the time. In this chapter, I was writing about the founding tradition of the United States as an anti-militarist, anti-imperialist nation, secure within its own shores, having nothing to do with the wicked armaments and standing armies of Europe, setting an example of unarmed strength and righteousness. Looking for material to illustrate the tradition, I found in a newspaper report these words of Eliot, which I haven't seen quoted by anyone else. "The building of a navy," he said, "and the presence of a large standing army mean the abandonment of what is characteristically American. The building of a navy, and particularly of battleships, is English and French policy. It should never be ours." How superb that is! Its assurance, its conviction, its Olympian authority, what does it not reveal of the man, the time, the idea? In those words, I saw clearly for the first time the nature and quality of the American anti-militarist tradition, of what has been called the American dream. It was a case of detail not merely corroborating, but revealing an aspect of history. Failing to know such details, one can be led astray. In 1890, Congress authorized the building of the first three American battleships, and 2 years later, a fourth. Shortly thereafter, in 1895, this country plunged into a major quarrel with Great Britain, known as the Venezuelan crisis, in which there was much shaking of fists and chauvinist shrieking for war. 3 years later, we were at war with Spain. She was no longer a naval power equal to Britain, of course, but still not negligible. One would like to know what exactly was American naval strength at the time of both these crises. How many, if any, of the battleships authorized in 1890 were actually at sea 5 years later? When the Jingoes were howling for war in 1895, what ships did we have to protect our coasts, much less to take the offensive? It seemed to me that this was a piece of information worth knowing. To my astonishment, on looking for the answer in textbooks on the period, I couldn't find it. The historians of America's rise to world power, of the era of expansion, of American foreign policy, or even of the Navy, haven't concerned themselves with what evidently seems to them an irrelevant detail. It was hardly irrelevant to policymakers of the time who bore the responsibility for decisions of peace or war. Text after text in American history is published every year, each repeating on this question more or less what his predecessor has said before, with no further enlightenment. To find the facts, I finally had to write to the Director of Naval History at the Navy Department in Washington. My point isn't how many battleships we had on hand in 1895 and 98, which I now know, but why this hard physical fact was missing from the professional historian's treatment. Bald and unconvincing, said Poobah of Narrative Without Fact, a judgment in which I join. When I come across a generalization or a general statement in history unsupported by illustration, I'm instantly on guard. My reaction is, show me. If a historian writes that it was raining heavily on the day war was declared, that's a detail corroborating a statement, let's say that the day was gloomy. But if he writes merely that it was a gloomy day without mentioning the rain, I want to know what is his evidence, what made it gloomy. Or if he writes, the population was in a belligerent mood, or it was a period of great anxiety. He's indulging in general statements which carry no conviction to me if they are not illustrated by some evidence. I write, for example, that fashionable French society in the 1890s imitated the English in manners and habits. Imagining myself to be my own reader, a complicated fugue that goes on all the time at my desk, my reaction is, of course, show me. The next two sentences do. I write, the Greffeul and Breteuil were intimates of the Prince of Wales. Le betting was the custom at Longchamp. Le derby was held at Chantilly. Le steeplechase at Auteuil, and an unwanted member was Black Boulet at the Jockey Club. Charles Haas, the original of Swan, had Mr. engraved on his calling cards. Even if corroborative detail didn't serve a valid historical purpose, its use makes a narrative more graphic and intelligible, more pleasurable to read, in short, more readable. It assists communication, and communication is, after all, the major purpose. History written in abstract terms communicates nothing to me. I can't comprehend the abstract, and since a writer tends to create the reader in his own image, I assume my reader can't comprehend it either. No doubt I underestimate him. Certainly many serious thinkers write in the abstract, and many people read them with interest and profit, and even, I suppose, pleasure. I respect this ability, but I am unable to emulate it. My favorite visible detail in The Guns of August, for some inexplicable reason, is the one about the Grand Duke Nicholas, who was so tall, 6'6", that when he established headquarters in a railroad car, his aide pinned up a fringe of white paper over the doorway to remind him to duck his head. Why this insignificant item after several years' work and out of all the material crammed into a book of 450 pages should be the particular one to stick most sharply in my mind, I can't explain, but it is. I was so charmed by the white paper fringe that I constructed a whole paragraph describing Russian headquarters at Baranovichi in order to slip it in logically. In another case, the process failed. I had read that the Kaiser's birthday gift to his wife was the same every year, 12 hats selected by him which she was obliged to wear. There you see the value of corroborative detail in revealing personality. This one is worth a whole book about the Kaiser, or even about Germany. It represents, however, a minor tragedy of the guns, for I never succeeded in working it in at all. I keep my notes on cards, and the card about the hats started out with those for the first chapter. Not having been used, it was moved forward to a likely place in chapter 2, missed again, and continued on down through the chapters until it emerged to a final resting place in a packet marked unused. A detail about General Sir Douglas Haig, equally revealing of personality, or at any rate of contemporary customs and conditions in the British officer corps, did find a place. This was the fact that during the campaign in the Sudan in the 90s, he had a camel laden with claret in the personal pack train that followed him across the desert. Besides being a vivid bit of social history, the phrase itself, a camel laden with claret, is a thing of beauty, a marvel of double and inner alliteration. That, however, brings up a whole other subject, the subject of language, which needs an article of its own for adequate discussion. Having inadvertently reached it, I'll only mention that the independent power of words to affect the writing of history is a thing to be watched out for. They have an almost frightening autonomous power to produce in the mind of the reader an image or idea that was not in the mind of the writer. Obviously, they operate this way in all forms of writing, but history is particularly sensitive because one has a duty to be accurate, and careless use of words can leave a false impression one hadn't intended. 50% at least of the critics of the guns commented on what they said was my exposé of the stupidity of the generals. Nothing of the kind was in my mind when I wrote. What I meant to convey was that the generals were in the trap of the circumstances, training, ideas, and national impulses of their time in their individual countries. I wasn't trying to convey stupidity, but tragedy, fatality. Many reviewers understood this, clearly intelligent, perceptive persons, those who understand one always are, but too many kept coming up with that word, stupidity, to my increasing dismay. This power of words to escape from a writer's control is a fascinating problem which, since it wasn't what I started out to discuss, I can only hint at here. One more hint before I leave it. For me, the problem lies in the fact that the art of writing interests me as much as the art of history, and I hope it's not provocative to say that I think of history as an art, not a science. In writing, I am seduced by the sound of words and by the interaction of their sound and sense. Recently, at the start of a paragraph, I wrote, "Then occurred the intervention which irretrievably bent the twig of events." It was intended as a kind of signal to the reader. Every now and then in a historical narrative, after one has been explaining a rather complicated background, one feels the need of waving a small red flag that says, "Wake up, reader, something's going to happen." Unhappily, after finishing the paragraph, I was forced to admit that the incident in question had not irretrievably bent the twig of events. Yet I hated to give up such a well-made phrase. Should I leave it in because it was good writing, or take it out because it wasn't good history? History governed, and it was lost to posterity, although you notice I have rescued it here. Words are seductive and dangerous material to be used with caution. Am I a writer first, or am I historian? The old argument starts inside my head. Yet there needn't always be dichotomy or dispute. The two functions needn't be, in fact shouldn't be, at war. The goal is fusion. In the long run, the best writer is the best historian. In quest of that goal, I come back to the ounce. The most effective ounce of visual detail is that which indicates something of character or circumstance in addition to appearance. Careless clothes finished off by drooping white socks corroborate a description of Jean Jaurès as looking like the expected image of a labor leader. The best corroborative detail I ever found concerned Lord Shaftesbury, the eminent Victorian social reformer, author of the Factory Act and Child Labor Laws, who appeared in my first book, Bible and Sword. He was a man, wrote a contemporary, of the purest, palest, stateliest exterior in Westminster, on whose classic head every separate dark lock of hair seemed to curl from a sense of duty. For conveying both the appearance and character of a man and the aura of his times, all in one, that line is unequaled. Novelists have the advantage that they can invent corroborative detail. Wishing to portray, let's say, a melancholy, introspective character, they make up physical qualities to suit. The historian must make do with what he can find, though he may sometimes point up what he finds by calling on a familiar image in the mental baggage of the reader. To say that General Joffre looked like Santa Claus instantly conveys a picture which struck me as peculiarly apt when I wrote it. I was thinking of Joffre's massive paunch, fleshy face, white mustache, and bland and benevolent appearance, and I forgot that Santa Claus wears a beard, which Joffre, of course, did not. Still, the spirit was right. One must take care to choose a recognizable image for this purpose. In my current book, I have a melancholy and introspective character, Lord Salisbury, Prime Minister in 1895, a supreme, if far from typical, product of the British aristocracy, a heavy man with a curly beard and big, bald forehead, of whom I wrote that he was called the Hamlet of English politics and looked like Karl Marx. I must say that I was really rather pleased with that phrase, but my editor was merely puzzled. It developed that he didn't know what Karl Marx looked like, so the comparison conveyed no image. If it failed its first test, it would certainly not succeed with the average reader, and so, sadly, I cut it out. Sources of corroborative detail must, of course, be contemporary with the subject. Besides the usual memoirs, letters, and autobiographies, don't overlook novelists and newspapers. The inspired bit about the ladies rising to their feet for General Mercier comes from Proust, as do many other brilliant details. For instance, that during the affair, ladies had "À bas les Juifs" printed on their parasols. Proust is invaluable not only because there's so much of him, but because it's all confined to a narrow segment of society which he knew personally and intimately. It's like a woman describing her own living room. On the other hand, another novel set in the same period, Jean Barois by Roger Martin du Gard, considered a major work of fiction on the affair, gave me nothing I could use, perhaps because visual detail, at least the striking and memorable detail, was missing. It was all talk and ideas, interesting, of course, but for source material I want something I can see. When you've read Proust, you can see Paris of the 90s, horse cabs in lamplight, the club man making his calls in white gloves stitched in black and gray top hats lined in green leather. Perhaps this illustrates the distinction between a major and a less gifted novelist, which should hold equally true, I believe, for historians. Ideas alone are not flesh and blood. Too often, scholarly history is written in terms of ideas rather than acts. It tells what people wrote instead of what they performed. To write, say, a history of progressivism in America or of socialism in the era of the Second International, by quoting the editorials, books, articles, speeches, and so forth of the leading figures, is easy. They were the worldliest people in history. If, however, one checks what they said and wrote against what actually was happening, a rather different picture emerges. At present, I'm writing a chapter on the socialists, and I feel like someone in a small rowboat under Niagara. To find and hold on to anything hard and factual under their torrent of words is an epic struggle. I suspect the reason is that people out of power always talk more than those who have power. The historian must be careful to guard against this phenomenon. Wait it, as the statisticians say, lest his result be unbalanced. Returning to novels as source material, I should mention The Edwardians by V. Sackville West, which gave me precise and authoritative information on matters on which the writers of memoirs remain discreet. Like Proust, this author was writing of a world she knew. At the great house parties, one learns, the hostess took into consideration established liaisons in assigning the bedrooms, and each guest had his name on a card slipped into a small brass frame outside his door. The poets serve, too. Referring in this chapter on Edwardian England to the central role of the horse in the life of the British aristocracy, and describing the exhilaration of the hunt, I used a line from a sonnet by Wilfred Scawen Blunt. "My horse a thing of wings, myself a god." Anatole France supplied the words to describe a Frenchman's feeling about the army at the time of the affair, that it was all that was left of our glorious past. It consoles us for the present and gives us hope of the future. Zola expressed the fear of the bourgeoisie for the working class through the manager's wife in Germinal, who, watching the march of the striking miners, saw the red vision of revolution when, on some somber evening at the end of the century, the people, unbridled at last, would make the blood of the middle class flow. In The Guns, there's a description of the retreating French army after the Battle of the Frontiers, with their red trousers faded to the color of pale brick, coats ragged and torn, cavernous eyes sunk in unshaven faces, gun carriages with once new gray paint now blistered and caked with mud. This came from Blasco Ibáñez's novel, The Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse. From H.G. Wells' Mr. Britling Sees It Through, I took the feeling in England at the outbreak of war that it contained an enormous hope of something better afterward, a chance to end war, a tremendous opportunity to remake the world. I don't know if the professors would allow the use of such sources in a graduate dissertation, but I see no reason why a novelist shouldn't supply as authentic material as a journalist or a general. To determine what may justifiably be used from a novel, one applies the same criterion as for any non-fictional account. If a particular item fits with what one knows of the time, the place, the circumstances, and the people, it's acceptable, otherwise not. For myself, I would rather quote Proust or Sackville West or Zola than a professional colleague, as is the academic habit. I could never see any sense whatever in referring to one's neighbor in the next university as a source. To me, that's no source at all. I want to know where a given fact came from originally, not who used it last. As for referring to an earlier book of one's own as a source, this seems to me the ultimate absurdity. I'm told that graduate students are required to cite the secondary historians in order to show they're familiar with the literature. But if I were granting degrees, I would demand primary familiarity with primary sources. The secondary histories are necessary when one starts out ignorant of a subject, and I'm greatly in their debt for guidance, suggestion, bibliography, and outline of events. But once they've put me on the path, I like to go the rest of the way myself. If I were a teacher, I would disqualify anyone who was content to cite a secondary source as his reference for a fact. To trace it back oneself to its origin means to discover all manner of fresh material from which to make one's own selection instead of being content to reuse something already selected by someone else. Though it's far from novels, I'd like to say a special word for who's who. For one thing, it's likely to be accurate because its entries are written by the subjects themselves. For another, it shows them as they wish to appear and thus often reveals character and even something of the times. H.H. Rogers, a Standard Oil partner and business tycoon of the 1890s, listed himself simply and succinctly as capitalist, obviously in his own eyes a proud and desirable thing to be. The social history of a period is contained in that self-description. Who would call himself by that word today? As to newspapers, I like them for period flavor, perhaps more than for factual information. One must be wary of using them for facts, because an event reported one day in a newspaper is usually modified or denied or turns out to be rumor on the next. It's absolutely essential to take nothing from a newspaper without following the story through for several days or until it disappears from the news. For period flavor, however, newspapers are unsurpassed. In the New York Times for August 10, 1914, I read an account of the attempt by German officers, disguised in British uniforms, to capture General Le Mans at Liège. The reporter wrote that the general's staff, maddened by the dastardly violation of the rules of civilized warfare, spared not but slew. This sentence had a tremendous effect on me. In it, I saw all the difference between the world before 1914 and the world since. No reporter could write like that today, could use the word dastardly, could take as a matter of course the concept of civilized warfare, could write unashamedly, spared not, but slew. Today the sentence is embarrassing. In 1914, it reflected how people thought and the values they believed in. It was this sentence that led me back to do a book on the world before the war. Women are a particularly good source for physical detail. They seem to notice it more than men, or at any rate to consider it more worth reporting. The contents of the German soldier's knapsack in 1914, including thread, needles, bandages, matches, chocolate, tobacco, I found in the memoirs of an American woman living in Germany. The Russian moose who wandered over the frontier to be shot by the Kaiser at Romington came from a book by the English woman who was governess to the Kaiser's daughter. Lady Warwick, mistress for a time of the Prince of Wales until she regrettably espoused socialism, is indispensable for Edwardian society, less for gossip than for habits and behavior. Princess Daisy of Pless prattles endlessly about the endless social realms of the nobility, but every now and then supplies a dazzling nugget of information. One which I used in the Zimmerman telegram was a description of how the Kaiser complained to her at dinner of the ill-treatment he had received over the Daily Telegraph affair, and of how, in the excess of his emotion, a tear fell on his cigar. In the memoirs of Edith O'Shaughnessy, wife of the first secretary of the American Embassy in Mexico, is the description of the German ambassador, von Hinze, who dressed and behaved in all ways like an Englishman, except that he wore a large sapphire ring on his little finger which gave him away. No man would have remarked on that. In the end, of course, the best place to find corroborative detail is on the spot itself, if it can be visited, as Herodotus did in Asia Minor or Parkman on the Oregon Trail. Take the question of German atrocities in 1914. Nothing requires more careful handling because, owing to post-war disillusions, atrocity came to be a word one didn't believe in. It was supposed because the Germans hadn't, after all, cut off the hands of Belgian babies, neither had they shot hostages nor burned Louvain. The results of this disbelief were dangerous, because when the Germans became Nazis, people were disinclined to believe they were as bad as they seemed, and appeasement became the order of the day. It strikes me that here is a place to put history to use, and that a certain wariness might be in order today. In writing of German terrorism in Belgium in 1914, I was at pains to use only accounts by Germans themselves, or in a few cases by Americans, then neutral. The most telling evidence, however, was that which I saw 45 years later. The rows of gravestones in the churchyard of a little Belgian village on the Meuse, each inscribed with a name and a date and the legend, Fusillé par les Allemands. Or the stone marker on the road outside Saint-Lys, 25 miles from Paris, engraved with the date September 2, 1914, and the names of the mayor and the 6 other civilian hostages shot by the Germans. Somehow the occupations engraved opposite the names, baker's apprentice, stonemason, garçon de café, carried extra conviction. This is the verisimilitude Poobah and I, too, have been trying for. The desire to find the significant detail, plus the readiness to open his mind to it and let it report to him, are half the historian's equipment. The other half, concerned with idea, point of view, the reason for writing, the why of history, has been left out of this discussion, although I'm not unconscious that it looms in the background. The art of writing is the third half. If that list doesn't add up, it's because history is human behavior, not arithmetic.
This ends History by the Arts. And now, the historian's opportunity.
Given the current decline of the novel and the parallel decline of poetry and the drama, public interest has turned toward the literature of actuality. It may be that in a time of widening uncertainty and chronic stress, the historian's voice is the most needed, the more so as others seem inadequate, often absurd. While the reasons may be argued, the opportunity, I think, is plain for the historian to become the major interpreter in literary experience of man's role in society. The task is his to provide both the matter to satisfy the public interest and those insights into the human condition, without which any reading matter is vapid. Historians have performed this role before. Although we have no figures on readership in classical Greece and Rome, it's evident from their continuers and imitators and from later references that Herodotus, Thucydides, and Tacitus, Polybius, Josephus, Plutarch, and the others were significant voices to their contemporaries. Since the outbreak of World War II, the statistics of the book trade reflect the growing appetite of the public for biography, autobiography, science, sociology, and history, especially contemporary history. The last category, as we've lately been made rather tiresomely aware, has its special problems, although in the long tradition of authorized biography, a subject's family has usually found quieter means than legal recourse for retaining control over personal matters. The simple way to keep private affairs private is not to talk about them, to the authorized or even the hired writer. I don't cite as evidence of the public interest in the literature of actuality the fact that since 1964, nonfiction, so-called, has outsold fiction by 2-to-1, because that merely reflects the mass buying of cookbooks and peace-of-mind books, the two frontrunners, plus voyeur books, that is, the sex life of everybody else, cartoon books and how-to books on baby care, home decorating, curing arthritis, counting calories, golf, etiquette, and that recent sleeper, avoiding probate. Non-books aside, by whatever criterion you use, number of titles published and book club choices, hardcovers and paperbacks, new titles and reprints, the categories concerned with reality all show greater increases than fiction. People are turning to the books of reality for a truer image of man and society than is offered by contemporary novels. To look for the reason why fictional truth has gone askew is part of the historian's task. The novelist's failure is a consequence, I believe, of the historical experience of the 20th century, which since the First World War has been one of man's cumulative disillusionment in himself. The idea of progress was the greatest casualty of that war, and its aftermath was cynicism, confirmed by a second round of world conflict and by the implications of the Nazis' gas chambers. Then the advent into man's hands of unlimited lethal power has been topped by the frightening pressure of overpopulation, so that now we live under the weight of a weird paradox which threatens us simultaneously with too many people in the world and too much power to destroy them. Finally, we're faced with mounting evidence in pollution of air and water, in destruction of the balance of nature, in the coming ear-shattering boom of supersonic flight, that we can't refrain from despoiling our environment. The experience has been enough to destroy in many of our generation their inherited belief in human goodness. Gilbert Murray found the same despair of the world overtaking the Greeks after their own period of prolonged internecine warfare, and ascribed it to a sense of the pressure of forces that man couldn't control or understand. Man in the 20th century is not a creature to be envied. Formerly, he believed himself created by the divine spark. Now, bereft of that proud confidence and contemplating his recent record and present problems, he can no longer, like the psalmist, respect himself as a little lower than the angels. He can't picture himself today, as Michelangelo did on the Sistine ceiling, in the calm and noble image of Adam receiving the spark from the finger of God. Overtaken by doubt of human purpose and divine purpose, he doubts his capacity to be good or even to survive. He has lost certainty, including moral and ethical certainty, and is left with a sense of footloose purposelessness and self-disgust, which literature naturally reflects. The result is what the Times Literary Supplement has named the Ugh School of Fiction. Writers who dislike their fellow men have taken over the literary world. The mainstream of their work is epitomized by the recent novel advertised as an engrossing treatment of more or less random adventures touching on thievery, homosexuality, pimping, sadism, voyeurism, a gangbang. Unaccountably, drug addiction was missing. As we all know, this isn't exceptional, but run-of-the-mill. And the drama, in the dreary examples that reach the stage today, does its best to keep pace. The preferred characters of current fiction are the drifters and derelicts of life, in whose affairs or ultimate fate it's impossible to sustain interest. They don't excite the question that's the heart of narrative, what happens next? Because one can't care what happens to them. Perhaps the fault isn't in the novelists, but in the times that their characters are underlings, anti-heroes who reflect a general sense of man as victim. Perhaps the novelist today can't honestly create a protagonist who is a master of his fate and captain of his soul, because man in the image of Henley seems obsolete. That man belonged to the self-confident 19th century, whereas the 20th finds its exponent in losers, beautiful losers, according to the title of a recent novel, although few seem to deserve the adjective. Oedipus was a loser, and so was King Lear, but their losing was universal and profound, not pointless. Since fiction and drama no longer present a true balance of human activity and motive, it's not to be wondered at that they are losing their audience. According to a recent report from the Capitol, official Washington doesn't read contemporary novels for the reason given by a sub-cabinet officer in these words, "I try to read them and give up. Why should I spend my time on books, where the central character spends 350 pages quivering about whether to cross the street or go to the toilet?" He has a point. Reading, which is to say writing, is the greatest gift with which man has endowed himself, by whose means we may soar on unlimited voyages. Are we to spend it picking through the garbage of humanity? Certainly the squalid and worthless, the mean and depraved, are part of the human story, just as dregs are part of wine. But the wine is what counts. Sexual perversion and hallucinatory drugs, as Eliot Fremont Smith said of a recent novel, are not what drive us, not what human history is about. The task then devolves upon historians to tell what human history is about, and what are the forces that do drive us. That's not to say that history excludes the squalid and depraved, but being concerned as it is with reality, and subject as it is to certain disciplines, it deals with these in proportion to the whole. Historians start with a great advantage over fiction, in that our characters, being public, are invested with power to affect destiny. They are the captains and kings, saints and fanatics, traitors, rogues and villains, pathfinders and explorers, thinkers and creators, even, occasionally, heroes. They are significant, if not necessarily admirable. They may be evil or corrupt or mad or stupid or even stuffed shirts, but at least, by virtue of circumstance or chance or office or character, they matter. They are the actors, not the acted upon, and are consequently that much more interesting. Readers want to see man shaping his destiny, or at least struggling with it, and this is the stuff of history. They want to know how things happened, why they happened, and particularly what they themselves have lived through. Just as, after a record heat or heavy snow, the first thing one turns to in the morning paper is the account of yesterday's weather. And now more than ever, when man's place in the world has never been so subject to question, when...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.